You're listening to the audio production of Your Daily Fill, 100 Days of Truth and Freedom to Heal America's Soul, by Phil Robertson, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Milton Bagby. Introduction. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people He chose for His inheritance. Psalm 33, verse 12. America was built on a godly foundation. Many, if not all, of the founding fathers considered the Bible as the framing of our country. They understood that virtue and morality couldn't exist without the influence of God. After all, these men had suffered greatly under the tyranny of a godless British king. So they came together to establish a republic firmly planted on the principles of God's Word, knowing that as long as we stayed true to our biblical foundation, America would be as enduring as the Scriptures themselves. But what did we do? Our politicians booted God out of schools, tried to boot God out of their platforms, and started promoting the slaughter of children in the womb. They removed the statues, signs, and symbols of our country's biblical heritage from the public square. They knelt for chaos and stood for evil. With God and His Word effectively canceled out of our culture, the idea began to spread that all truth is relative. The prevailing attitude of the day is, follow your own desires and make your own truth. In today's America, everyone's personal truth must be accepted and celebrated, that is, except for biblical morality. That is the one truth that must be silenced at all costs. It's clear that the enemy of our country's soul has come to steal, kill, and destroy everything our founding fathers stood for. How has he shattered America's soul? He's done it through division, hatred, and the dismantling of our nation's biblical foundation. What can help bridge these divisions and heal our nation? Can secular humanists, smooth-talking celebrities, or progressive politicians unify us? They haven't yet, and they never will. Spiritual problems need spiritual solutions, not political ones. The truth is, governments and ideologies can't remove sin, and they can't defeat death. They just can't do it. There will never be hope in hollow and deceptive philosophies full of your truth and his truth and her truth. There is only one truth, and we need a mass awakening to it. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John chapter 14, verse 6. There's a simple solution to all our disunity, and it's the absolute truth of God's Word. We can return to the Almighty and understand how He has created us to be unified under His message, that we all are created in His image, and He loves us all without distinction. Jesus came to destroy the divisions between people, to bring all of us into the family of everlasting life. After His death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, He sent the Spirit of the Almighty to the disciples, and through that Spirit He showed them just how He intends to bring people of all makes and models into the fold. Well, listen up. America won't make it another generation without the healing that comes from Christians who are committed to living out the truth of God's Word. Our nation needs Christians who will live out our faith by doing what we can do every day to love God, love our neighbor, and do what's right, no matter who's running the government. That's the only way the soul of our nation will be healed. In this 100-day reader, we will focus on God-honoring principles that will heal America's soul. If you're serious about being the kind of Christian who can make a real difference in our nation, then join me as we discover how to stand firm in our faith and lead our families well by championing the truth and freedom that come only from God and His Word. Part 1. Truth. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 6. Day 1. Is God dead? The Lord is the true God. He is the living God, the eternal King. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 10. In April 1966, Time raised a ruckus when it printed this question on its cover, Is God dead? It was a shocking cover posing a shocking question, and that question took root in the public dialogue of the day. Scientists, preachers, insurance agents, housewives, everyone from New York to California was drawn into the discussion. Even us river rats down in northern Louisiana. But if the cover was provocative, the story inside the magazine was even more provocative. Is God dead? The article asked. A small band of radical theologians has seriously argued that the churches must accept the fact of God's death and get along without Him. Huh? The disappearance of God in art, politics, and economics led to the death of God, some claimed in the article. Modern science had undermined or explained the mysteries of God in the natural world, others said. This Time article explored the very things I'd hear on my college campus at Louisiana Tech University later that year. Man's ancestors crawled out of the salt water, they said. Man's notions of right and wrong were taught, handed down. Morality was a set of fabricated human constructs, they said. Morality was relative. Sexuality was relative. Nothing was absolute. God, the old white-bearded judge in the sky, was a myth. What's more, professor after professor implied that if man could liberate himself from this archaic myth, he'd find true freedom. Man could be his own judge. Man could be his own master. Man could be the arbiter of his own freedom. Man could be the center of his own existence. It's been more than 50 years since the publication of that Time article, and almost as many years since I was freed from the lies written about in that article. How was I freed? Only through an encounter with the living God. The last time I checked, God ain't dead. He's very much alive. It's a fact. What's more, the polls I've seen indicate that the vast majority of Americans know this to be true. Nearly 90% of Americans believe in God. But despite the fact that God isn't dead, despite the fact that the majority of us believe that to be true, why do so many Americans seem to continue toward death and destruction? I suppose the devil makes them do it. Time presented Friedrich Nietzsche's thesis, self-centered man had killed God, and that settled that. Here's what Nietzsche failed to realize. That declaration was far from settled. Here's what else he failed to realize. If the God of the Bible is dead, man has no hope of experiencing eternal life. Of course, Nietzsche discovered that truth just after he took his last breath. Nanoseconds after crossing over death's threshold, the German philosopher stood at the judgment seat of the wild, fearsome Lord of the universe, the living God. It's been 4 decades since my encounter with God, and I can tell you I'm not running from anyone or anything. I'm not enslaved to the isms of the world. And if America would awaken to that same truth, the truth and good news Jesus came to bring us, it might just change everything. Lord, I praise you for being the living God who reigns forever. In a nation deceived by the lies of the devil, help me to focus on the truth, knowing that you are very much alive and at work in the world today. Day 2. The Lies of the Deceiver. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, and there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. John chapter 8, verse 44. Despite our nation's biblical foundation, America's most influential thinkers and leaders began to say, God is dead, trying to convince themselves it was true. And as they said it over and over again, they began to tell themselves this too. Truth is dead, or at least relative. Questioning the absolute truth of God's existence opens the door to all sorts of other questions too. If God is dead, what does he have to say? Nothing. If his word isn't true, what is the Bible but a good story and an ancient moral code? Probably nothing. If the Bible is nothing more than a good story, is there really an evil one himself? It's doubtful. If the Bible is only an ancient moral code, how can it apply today? It probably doesn't. If it doesn't apply, can there be a penalty for breaking that moral standard? Can there be a hell? It's uncertain at best. If there's no hell, why did Christ die? Who knows, really? He was probably just a lunatic. This is the way it all breaks down, see? If the very existence of God is in question, then so are the absolute truths spoken by that God in the Bible. At best, those truths are relative, they argue. And if all truth is relative, then aren't we free to chase our desires? What's keeping us from acting on every sexual impulse? Why not say what we want, drink what we want, take every advantage we can get? Why not abort babies, steal, murder? If there's no absolute standard for truth, who can say these things are wrong? As I see it, there's only one problem with this line of thinking, and it's a big problem. It's all based on the lie that God is dead, a lie created by the deceiver himself, Satan. Throughout the Bible, the evil one has been known as a deceiver, a liar, and the lawless one. Jesus said he was a murderer and a liar from the beginning. As he said in the Gospel of John, when he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Chapter 8, verse 44. Paul told us that he comes disguised as an angel of light. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14. Maybe like one of those enlightened university professors, modern scientists, or politicians. Though Satan has deceived men over and over again, Paul warned us of his schemes. He taught us exactly how the devil and his end-time servant, the lawless one, operate. In his second letter to the Thessalonians, Paul wrote, "The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with how Satan works. He will use all sorts of displays of power through signs and wonders that serve the lie, and all the ways that wickedness deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refused to love the truth and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness." Chapter 2, verses 9 through 12. Lies, lies, lies. They're the only weapon the evil one has in his arsenal. He uses those weapons against the human race, trying to deceive them so they'll turn away from God, so they'll forget his truths and chase their own desires down to death. See, when God is dead, so is his divine truth. And without divine truth, without truth to govern our human conduct, we fall for the devil's lie. God, so many people in our nation have been blinded by the lies of the devil. We need your truth, revealed in your word. Help me to study the scriptures and share your truth with others. Day 3. The truth that sets us free.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.